So I want to start by thanking the Mount Wilson Observatory for hosting this occasion. But this occasion wouldn't have happened if it weren't for George Ellery Hale's grandsons, who are here with us today. And the eldest grandson is Brack Hale, sitting right here. And Sam Hale is right next to me. Brack Hale actually knew his grandfather, remembers him. And I think, as I remember some of the stories, Brack, you used to remember when your grandfather would take you over to the solar lab and tell you that there were maybe some goblins down in the bottom of it. Scary a little bit, but basically he was a wonderful grandfather to you.
Yes, every Sunday we'd have lunch with him here. Invite my mother and father and my brother. He wasn't born.
Yes, Sam wasn't born yet. And then over here, Don Nicholson also remembers George Ellery Hale. And I don't know, do you have any brief memory you could share with us, Don, of George Ellery Hale?
Yes, but I really didn't know Hale. I met him, of course, but he was so busy doing other things.
That's right. Yes, that I'm sure is true. Where is Bruce? Bruce Babcock is also here. His father ran the Mount Wilson Observatory for quite a while. His grandfather worked very closely with George Ellery Hale. So it's really nice that we have these living connections here to the history. With that, I want to turn it over to Sam, who's going to say a few things about the project that Robin and I did, and a little more specifically about Robin. Sam?
Okay. Thank you, Todd. Of course, Todd and Robin's contribution to the memory of my grandfather and the illumination of a whole generation who never knew anything about my grandfather, probably never heard of my grandfather, was wrapped up in this seminal work, The Journey to Palomar. And The Journey to Palomar, however, obviously we're not at Palomar, we're at Mount Wilson, but the journey would have never gotten to Palomar without the road through Mount Wilson, through my grandfather's building the two largest telescopes in succession that the world at that point knew. Fresh from building the largest refracting telescope in the world at Williams Bay, Wisconsin, the Yerkes Observatory. I don't think the paint was dry on Yerkes when he was on a train to Mount Wilson with the idea in mind of building the largest reflecting telescope in the world as soon as he could figure out where he was going to get the money. Probably one of the most understated and underappreciated talents of my grandfather was as a salesman. And he sold Charles Yerkes, a Chicago scoundrel, on building the Yerkes telescope. Then he convinced Andrew Carnegie to fund the 60-inch telescope right behind us, and then the Rockefeller Foundation to build the 200-inch telescope at Palomar. So the road to Palomar came through Mount Wilson, and after building, during the time that he built the two telescopes, the 60-inch there, the 100-inch there, this completed in 1908, the 100-inch completed in 1917, as I say, were the successively the two largest reflecting telescopes in the world at the time, and then until 1920, GEH was the director of the Mount Wilson Observatories. I would like to think that even though I may be doubted, I'd like to think his heart is here. But I think in reality, his heart was always, where's the next biggest telescope that I'm going to build? That's what he was all about. But our hearts are here. And our hearts or with her. I want to thank my brother Brack for coming all the way for this ceremony, for the support of my wife Sylvia, and a person that I know we missed is our oldest brother George, who died 3 years before Todd and Robin began this project, and George was here at the founding of the Mount Wilson Institute, which basically took over the running of all the facilities on the mountain. And the other person that we miss is Arthur Vaughn. And Ann is with us today. But Art, if there was a creator of Mount Wilson Institute, it was Art Vaughn. Anyway, I had a chance this week to, excuse me, I tell I'm a little emotional about this whole thing, but I had a chance to talk with Todd at some length about Robin, about their involvement in the creation of the Journey to Palomar, and Todd was telling me that in 1998 they were doing promotional videos and were successful commercial ventures, but they were looking for a little spark, something that would get them excited. And at that time, Todd said he had a conversation with a friend, Craig Hogan. Craig said, why don't you go down and take a look at Mount Palomar? And you might find it interesting. Well, Palomar, then a visit to the Carnegie Institution down in Pasadena, and then the solar tower here set the hook. And what Todd and Robin decided is that maybe a 20 or 30 minute documentary on George Ellery Hale might be kind of interesting. And well, as we know, as Todd described it, mission creep took over, and what was going to be maybe a year's project turned into a 10-year voyage for them. And mission creep really took over. And Todd said that what they both felt as teenagers growing up in the 60s with the Apollo project, with the can-do, Americans can do anything that they set their minds to, and then learning about GEH back at the turn of the 20th century and the things that he did, the really creating modern astronomy, creating cosmology, being an author of astrophysics terms and disciplines that took a sharp turn to the modern age at that point. This was something that really, really grabbed them. And so off they set. They toured the country, interviewing, researching, an incredible deep project that they undertook. And Todd kind of taking care of the engineering aspect of it, Robin taking care of the sort of the human aspect of GEH. And two things kind of stand out, and I think my brother Brack would agree, was at some point into the project, Robin called us. And she said, you know, we've discovered that your grandfather had some significant mental challenges, some emotional challenges and physical challenges. And you know, we don't know how much you want us to get into this because this is private. It's a family affair. And Brack and I said, this is something that the world ought to know about, because here is a man who overcame incredible challenges physically and mentally to do what he did, and we think this could be an inspiration to the world. The other thing that Robin and Todd did for us was they introduced me to a side of my family that I'd never met before. I mean, amazingly enough, Todd and Robin introduced us to Sylvia and me, to my cousin, Brax, and my first cousin, Ann James, who is GEH's oldest grandchild. I am GEH's youngest grandchild. And she was really the keeper of the flame on all of the memorabilia on my grandfather. She knew him as a child. Ann is now, I think, 94 years old. She remembers him coming to Medford, Oregon, where they lived, and playing with them. Has incredible pictures of him. Anyway, so Robin and Todd brought our family a little closer together. I mean, Brack knew this side of the family, but I, being a caboose kid, never got a chance to meet them. Anyway, and from, I think, Todd shared with me from Robin's childhood, she had some challenges. She had some issues, maybe family issues, growing up that were tough on her. And she overcame them, and I think she saw in George Ellery Hale a hero. And a hero that overcame the kind of things that she thought she overcame, and she could share with the world the challenges that this man was able to scale. So while the scientific accomplishments are so much a incredible part of a journey to Palomar, I think that the human story and the human story that Robin unearthed through seeking the real truth of this man's life, I think this heroine, she found a hero. And she brought him to life for a generation that I think we can say we need heroes like this. Thank you.
It's impossible to capture the essence of a life, Robin's life, in a few words, or even all the words in the universe. When I think of Robin, I see images. Robin, charming an audience of some of the finest minds of the world. Robin, delighting in the wonders of the natural world, awed by the stars above the Anza Borrego Desert, or the sun's fading rays on the waves in Redondo Beach. Robin, arriving in all her glory on her motorbike. Robin, laughing and wanting to share her latest adventure. Robin, at the tiller of her life, guiding it through both smooth waters and the most daunting storms. Robin, again, bravely sharing some of the shadows that haunted her in order to help teach a grateful class of graduate students in psychology. Most of all, I think of Robin always, always bringing something to the party, whether arriving at the door or welcoming us through hers. Robin was ready with a lovingly prepared dish of something delicious, with her delight at being part of a gathering, with her ready laugh and curiosity, and always with her willingness to participate, no matter what, no matter how hard the journey to get there sometimes was. Robin loved life, and she loved the people lucky enough to be a part of hers. She was always striving to create home, a safe haven for herself, for Todd, for us.
I'm John Stoddard. These are words, though, that were written by Todd. It's a poem that he wrote about her. Robin, you must have come from the stars. You appeared one day and soared through our lives as a comet, shining brightly and illuminating our path. You lifted our spirits. You always laughed and glowed with contagious enthusiasm. You were, as one friend said, one of the finest collections of atoms and molecules on the planet. You were a devoted wife, a passionate lover of music, and supporter of the arts. You were a talented cook, organizer, an amazing host and friend. But most of all, you embraced human curiosity, and then you learned how to share that with others. No small feat. We're here today because of you, Robin. Because of you, millions of people learned about George Ellery Hale's triumph against all odds to pursue the very truth of our universe. Hale's story resonated with you because you also wanted to know the deeper truths of our history, our world, and the stars above. For years, you researched countless dusty archives. You uncovered rare photos, film footage, and old newspaper clippings. You connected dots in a sea of endless dots. In making the Journey to Palomar documentary, you traveled across the country numerous times and interviewed many of our nation's top scientists and authors. You gave lectures at our leading planetariums, the Huntington Library, NASA, the National Academy of Science, and the Carnegie Institution, among others. You did all this because you wanted to make sure that this story, Hale's story, was not lost in the noise of history, and that young kids in particular would be inspired to engage in their own pursuit of the truth, perhaps even to become astronomers, and perhaps to make new discoveries of their own. Even though your own journey here on Earth was far too brief, we're here now to celebrate you and to tell you that you succeeded by any measure. You absolutely made this world a better place. As we stand here in this location, this sacred location, we realize how fitting it is. You came from the stars into our lives. And now, from this very mountaintop, where the universe was discovered, you are now once again closer to the stars. Okay, at this point, we'd like to open up the floor to anyone else who would like to share some memories of Robin.
Actually, John, I've slight change in plan.
Okay. We're not going to do that now.
Okay. I you didn't know about this.
Okay.
But I have a couple of things here for the Hale brothers.
Robin collected all kinds of Hale things where she could and found materials that no one else had found, not just at famous archives, but sometimes with private individuals who just donated things to her because they were so swept up in her own curiosity. Two of the things that she ended up with are two charcoal drawings that George Ellery Hale made himself when he was in Italy in the year 1911. And I have two of them here. I'd like to present one each to Sam and Brack Hale.
Finally, before we pull the veil off here, I just want to thank a couple of people who were instrumental in helping to make this happen. And let's see, where's Tom? Tom Meneghini, thank you so much for helping to coordinate this. Craig also did quite a bit, and I think there's a third person.
Lawrence.
That's our craftsman.
Thank you. And so with that, let's take a look. I would like to give this opportunity to anybody who would like to share a brief memory or just say a few brief words that they remember about Robin. Don't be bashful. Come up and say something.
Well, I remember Robin in the very best sense of the word professional. She knew her work and she loved doing it. And I was fortunate to be able to evaluate that, having traveled a bit of that journey to Palomar myself. Thank you.
My name is Matthew Stotter,
and I knew Robin very well and very long, and the thing that I carry with me every single day, and I think of her every single day, is her humor and her sense of hope. And I think that even through her long and difficult struggle, I can still hear her, the tone of her voice being so hopeful and so forward-looking, but also seeing the humor in everything. And I think that in my darkest days and my hardest times, I always think of her in the way that she viewed life, handled life, thought of life, and then also touched others. And the last thing I'd like to say, too, is that I'm fortunate to have three children, almost four now, and she always was so delicate and caring and wonderful with my children and really thoughtful about them. And really, whenever she was around them, they would light up and they would be drawn to her energy and her beauty, and perhaps it was her attitude of hope and grace and humor. But she was always somebody that they just loved and loved to be around. That's something I will always remember as well. So I just wanted to carry that forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Mike Mason. I am proud to be his older brother and a best friend of Robin. Whenever I think of two words, positive and curious, I think of her. She was an amazing, amazing sister-in-law, amazing friend. And on behalf of the family, I just want to thank everyone for everyone's effort in making this possible. I know it means more than we can ever know. So thank you.
I am just inspired, to say the least. I am an old friend of Todd and Robin, and I really miss her because she taught me so much. I'm also a cancer survivor, you know, and she taught me a lot, because every time my husband and I would go and visit Todd and Robin when she was really struggling, you know, having so much pain sometimes and trying to hide it so much, that's inspired me so much, because most people want pity. You know, when you're really feeling so bad, you just want to get pity from people, but not Robin. Robin was the opposite. She would not ever talk about how she felt. She wanted to know how you were feeling. How was your day? How did it go? She could still be so enthusiastic, even in the midst of her most excruciating pain. So she just, and another thing is, you know, just seeing her face, even when I knew she was suffering, she still gave me hope. She still taught me, you know, how to love and how to inspire others. I'm a musician, so that's what I do. I try to share my music. And always enthusiastically, even though I didn't play so well, she said, "Oh, Heike, you sounded great." So that's, anyway, I really thought it's really an inspiration. And thank you. Thank you so much for letting me say this.
Thank you. I'm Seth Stotter. I'm the caboose of at least one generation of the Stotter family, brother to John and to Matt. And something about Robin. She was, it's amazing. Something about her, something disarming about her. I mean, I think somebody, when we're talking about the film and how the Todd and Robin sort of divided the tasks of sort of thinking about the film, but every time I've seen this film, I get emotional, because it's in a very emotional film, because it's a very human film. And it's not just about George Ellery Hale, but it's also in his sort of human struggles, but about all of us in the sense of, and sort of the history of all of us and where we all come from. And it's a very emotional film, and Robin was like that. I mean, she could kind of cut through the, sometimes the intellectual sort of side that we all have. You know, it could be just something as simple and disarming as one of her lethal, good grief, that would just hit you right between the eyes and humanize you. And just miss her to death. So, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Gail Malikian, and I have worked on many video projects with Todd and Robin. So they were the commercial projects that were the ones before they had the Palomar project. So I'm not saying that I'm responsible for that project, but maybe just a little bit. All of the long hours that Todd and Robin worked together as a team, I mean, working with your husband, you know, it's kind of amazing. I was always so impressed with how patient they were with each other. It was incredible. They were just, I mean, it really in the nicest sense, they had such a lovely relationship with each other. And Robin was just always so amazingly supportive of Todd, no matter what. And so, and you know, when you work with somebody, you tend to keep a professional distance, but I was never able to do that with Robin and Todd. They're, you know, wonderful people, and I loved Robin to death and loved Todd and miss Robin, and so happy that we have this really beautiful spot to sit and think and remember her and be in this beautiful spot in nature. So I just wanted to say that, and thank you all.
I'm Liz Hogan. Todd is my cousin, and I have Todd and Robin to thank for introducing Phil Hogan to me. It wasn't until Robin came to visit us one time, and she talked about how she was so thrilled to find the human aspect of the story. And she was researching it, and she was telling us about the research, and it made me realize that there is this whole other aspect to the technological side and the human story side of Journey to Palomar. And it made me realize her role in the making of the movie, the research. So I've always been a huge admirer of Todd and Robin, and I want to thank all of you for coming and being here, and it's a wonderful, wonderful memory. Thank you, Todd.
Thank you, Liz. I'm Phil Hogan. I'm Liz's husband. I've known Todd since, grade school. We grew up together. And later, Todd and I both went to school on the East Coast together, and I got to know Robin, who was also living in New York City. And again, she was an inspiration to all of us, a wonderful, wonderful person, a wonderful woman. And I'm so grateful that Mount Wilson and the Hale family and all of you are able to join us here to honor Robin's memory here today.